I remember when I was about 4 or 5, and I see my mother praying, and out of that, she'd been praying during hard times when things were going right in the family, and I'd see it, and I learned that Jesus was important, but I also learned from her praying that Jesus is with us. But I remember being afraid of the dark. And after that, it didn't bother me once I figured out that Jesus was with me in that room. And which sort of brings me to another story. I used to pastor at Beulah, and they got a ghost. I know for a fact they got a ghost because I would hear the ghost at night. I'd be out up in the office working 9 or later, and the downstairs door would slam, and I'd hear somebody walking across the fellowship hall, and there would be nobody near, there would be no lights on, there would be no cars in the parking lot, and this would happen often. And I'd be talking to somebody, and we'd hear voices in the social hall, and there was nobody in there. But people were like, "Oh, what did you do when you heard the cry?" I was like, "I kept working." They're like, "How could you keep working knowing the ghost was walking around?" And I said, "Well, Jesus is with me. I don't have to worry about the ghost. Jesus is with me. I also made a deal with it. I told it, if you don't bother me, I won't cast you out." Remember, Jesus is with you. It doesn't matter what you're going through. You know he's there. So why do I believe in Jesus? I know he's with me. He's been with me through all the problems of my life. And being quite frank, what other options do I have? Other religions say that I can get to a near version of heaven if I'm just good enough, but I know that in and of myself that I am not good and can never be good enough. So their promises are a false hope. Maybe I should be an atheist and just live this life and then die and have nothing to look forward to afterwards. Well, that isn't even a promise of hope. I mean, it's got to be just about as depressing as you can get. Solomon was living in a time where they didn't have a hope of an afterlife. And he writes, Ecclesiastes. "Then I said to myself, what happens to the fool will happen to me also. Why then have I been so very wise? And I said to myself that this also is vanity, for there is no enduring remembrance of the wise or the fools, seeing that in the days to come all will have been long forgotten." That was his hope. Lack of hope, it was his depression. He knew that the fool would be just as well off as him. They'd both die and be forgotten. With atheism, you have no hope, and what you build is just vanity because it will not last. And then Paul says, "For the Jews to be in science and the Greeks desire wisdom, but we proclaim Christ crucified, a stumbling block to the Jews and foolishness to the Gentiles." Well, Paul could have been writing about today. Some want science. He says, "Well, if God would just appear before me, if Jesus would just appear before me, I'll believe." Well, you know what? Jesus was walking around on earth in front of thousands of people doing miracles, and there were still people who didn't believe. And it would happen today, and people would say, "That's a neat trick." Some have been educated and brainwashed not to believe. And if you get past age 12 or 13, you go from a 32% chance of believing in Jesus to 4%, because we've already set in our ways, we have our beliefs and our habits already established, and we don't like change. I believe in Jesus for several reasons. I believe in Jesus because I believe in the Bible. I believe in the Jesus of the Bible. And the major reason I believe in the Jesus of the Bible is that the Bible doesn't sugarcoat Jesus. Even though today we make Jesus a guy who wouldn't hurt a fly, if you read the Bible, that ain't him. Learned that word eight while getting my master's degree. The Bible shows people loving and hating him. People following him and people opposing him. The Bible shows Jesus willing to be abused, whipped, and crucified on a cross for others. And the Bible shows Jesus forgiving people and loving them even when they betrayed him. The Bible shows Jesus flipping over tables and whipping people who abused others. It showed him saying, you know, if you don't go along with our plan, you're going to burn. That's not somebody who wouldn't hurt a fly. Think about the Jesus of the Bible. Some dropped what they were doing to follow him. Some followed him to see what they could get. They wanted healing. They wanted food. Some of them, he was the only show around, and they went for the entertainment. Most of the people in authority wanted to kill him. He said things that drove people insane with anger and hate. They wanted to get rid of him. They worked in secret to get rid of him, meeting with Judas in the dark. Most congregations today would have a group of people trying to get rid of Jesus or undermine his ministry or whispering in the dark if you were their pastor. Most churches would not like having Jesus or Paul as their pastor. They were too blunt. They told it like it is. They didn't care about your feelings. While some were plotting against Jesus, others were changed for the better by accepting his word. Jesus didn't make shallow promises to his followers about how they were going to get rich and powerful like some popular pastors today. Pick up your cross and follow me. You're going to be persecuted and you're going to be killed if you're my follower. And he had followers who spread his word and suffered for it. He also had friends like Judas who smiled to his face and stabbed him in the back. None of us know anything about that, right? Being stabbed in the back by a smiling friend. So the Bible shows a real person. Going through all the things that we go through. Close friends you can count on and backstabbing friends. But people who support him and people who were out abusing others. I believe in Jesus because he changed and is changing many lives for the better, and many people, unknowingly followers of Satan, will not tolerate that because it changes their world and makes them uncomfortable. We do hate change, don't we? I hate change. I don't really like it. I'm really scared for my kids and grandkids. The world's changing so fast. But the fact is, change is going to happen whether I like it or not. I believe in Jesus because there is no hope without him. There is no salvation. There's no forgiveness. I have nothing to look forward to. For the message of the cross is foolishness to those who are perishing, but to us who are being saved, it is the power of God. Without Jesus, there's no eternal life. I don't get to see my firstborn son who died at birth. I don't get to see my parents who are both dead. I don't get to see my grandparents, one of whom I never saw in my life as he lived in Oregon. And he died a couple years before we finally went out there. Different close friends who have died, I don't get to see them if I don't have faith in Jesus Christ. I believe in Jesus because I have known him for most of my life, and I know that he has been with me for all of my life.
Yes.
From my early childhood, he's been my best friend. The one I can always count to be there for me when everybody else has abandoned me. He was there. He's changed my life. Say to people, you want my job, and they all go, man. No, I got the job nobody wants. So what am I doing here if I don't believe in Jesus? There's easier ways to make money. When you believe in him, you see him changing lives. And whether it's a member of a church or pastor of a church, I have seen him changing so many lives for the better. And when you believe his word, you follow him, you join in his work, and your life starts to change. And when a church, as a church, when you believe his word and you follow him and you join in his work, churches start growing. That is one of the reasons why most churches in the United States aren't growing. People worship buildings, or the fellowship group they're in, or the music, not Jesus. But when you believe in Jesus, things change. In beautiful downtown Lando, where you do not accidentally drive through Lando, you have to go looking for Lando, and it had one mill that owned almost every house in town, and the mill had closed, and they were all abandoned, and the houses were collapsing. And I got sent there, and they actually had 55 in attendance. And I remember my first couple of Sundays, I said, it doesn't matter what those houses are doing out there, that they were abandoned and collapsing, and that nobody lives in them. It doesn't matter because it has nothing to do with what Jesus is doing in and through this church. And they rapidly grew to 66 in attendance, which may not sound like much to you all, but when you have more people attending your church than live in the town, I would have been the most proud church I've been to. I've never had another church where I had more people attending church than lived in the town. But if you believe in Jesus as a church, the church starts to grow. And if it ain't growing, it's because you don't believe in Jesus. You don't trust him to do the things he's asking you to do. I believe in Jesus Christ, my Lord, my best friend, my strength, my purpose in life, and my Savior. I believe in Jesus Christ and him crucified. What do you believe? What does your life say that you believe? Let us pray. Lord, help us to truly believe in you, so that we might change, so that we might grow in your image, so that we might inspire and influence others to grow and change. And Lord, we just ask that you help us as a church to embrace you and accept the changes that you call for us to make, so that your church might grow and that and become a major influence in the life of this community. In Christ's name we pray.